peace be upon him, said that if they let them do that, then the entire ship sinks. Otherwise, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said that the entire ship is saved. So the point is, there's so many different things. Actually, I teach a class called Prophetic Musings.
Yeah.
Some of the analogies of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And I go into quite some depth with this example. There's so many things. Number one, there's an African proverb that if the youth are not initiated into the village, they will burn it down to feel its warmth.
Mm-hmm.
And subhanAllah, there are a lot of times where you see that. There are people that are away from Allah, away from Islam, but no one's reaching out to them. So there's a disconnect between the religious class and the not-so-religious class. There's grouping. And so the masjid even, the mosque, becomes a clinic that doesn't accept sick people. You know,
mm-hmm.
People who have issues in their lives don't go to the masjid, nor are they made to feel welcome in the masjid, in the mosque, because they're not dressed properly, they're not worshiping properly, they don't know how to pray. We know what's really going on in your life. The masjid is supposed to be for everyone. So the religious class is supposed to go out to those that are falling and faltering and give them advice lovingly and not make them feel like they're irritating them. You know, I was reading a study from the Pew Research Center about churches in America. And they were saying that young people are turned off by the church because they feel intimidated by the elderly, for example. There's a sense of intimidation. So that intimidation factor has to be removed, and that can be removed from loving advice, and you know, and in fact, one of the other meanings of nasiha is to bond.
Mm-hmm.
It brings people together, and so sometimes that time when you sit down your brother and you talk to him in a loving way and you give him advice, it's not about the issue at hand anymore. He now trusts you. He loves you. He appreciates the way that you came to him, and so nasiha actually brings people together. And so that's what the Prophet, peace be upon him, is teaching us, that when you see something on Facebook or see something on YouTube or see something on Twitter or hear about something, you know, with someone that you know, you should give them the dignity of sitting with them and saying, look, I love you, I care about you. If you need anything, let me know. If there's a reason why you've resorted to the sin, because a lot of times we just condemn without asking why, perhaps, what led to that sin. Now, why did the people drill the hole in the ship? Because they were thirsty. So why do people commit sin? Because there was something missing in their lives. So perhaps someone committed, you know, a sin because there were family issues. So the point is that I need to also, part of my giving advice is showing concern. Is everything okay? Why did you resort to that in the first place? How can I help you? How can I be there for you? And inshallah ta'ala, I will tell you a story, inshallah, as well, that I just thought of afterwards. Inshallah.
You got the story ready? Okay, we're going to take a break, and exactly. Then we're going to come back with more. And to wrap it up here, with Sh.Omar Suleiman giving that loving advice. We'll be right back on the Deen Show.
I am not afraid to stand alone.
Back here on the Deen Show, and we're talking about the right way to give advice and the right way and the wrong way. And then you had a story before we went to break. Please share it with us.
So this was a story, actually, someone that took Shahada with me. He became Muslim with me, you know, in college. And you know, for a few years, he disappeared from the masjid scene. He disappeared from the mosque. He really wasn't involved in the religion anymore. And he calls me out of the blue 3-4 years later. And I pick up the phone, and I was so shocked that it was him. And, you know, he's going off on Islam, going off on Allah, going off on the Prophet, peace be upon him, just saying blasphemous things. And he's trying to start an argument. And I wasn't responding to him. Okay, so I was being quiet. And, you know, at the end, basically, where he ranted on the religion and things of that sort, you know, I told him, I said, well, you know, I'm sorry that you feel that way, and to each his own. You know, I certainly don't agree with some of the things that you said. And, you know, hopefully one day we can get together. It's been a long time since we've seen each other anyway. Hopefully one day we can get together, mm-hmm. and we can kind of discuss these issues again. He was like, wait, that's it? He was surprised that I didn't go off on him. So I was like, yeah, I was like, you know, you're entitled to your views, but, you know, I miss you, man. I haven't seen you for a long time. So mm-hmm. when are we going to get together and maybe we can discuss this over lunch? So then he just broke down crying. And so I realized that there was something deeper than that. And so he starts to tell me about some things that were going on with his family. And he starts to tell me about some things going on in his life, some personal issues. And I helped him with that. And then next thing you know, he's back at Jum'ah. He's back in Islam. So his issue was never theological in the first place. It was a cry for help. It was a cry for attention. And so sometimes we have to understand that people that sin, people that mess up online, people that post outrageous photos or start saying certain things, it's really a cry for help. And as a brother, as a sister, just as I'd be concerned for my sibling, I wouldn't just want to correct them with the sin. I'd want to make sure that I help them and that I'm there for them. I'd be concerned about their mental health, their spirituality, so on and so forth. I should afford that same thing to my brother and sister in faith.
Let's go to the flip side for the person getting the advice too. So we know that you giving the advice, you should go out of your way to be loving and kind, giving loving advice. But let's say you've gotten some advice. You've gotten it 10, 20 times, and maybe you didn't get it, you know, sugar-coated the way you'd like with roses and candy and all that. How should you also, because we know that the Creator tells us that advice benefits the believer, right? So, and then there's a flip side to it. It increases.
Don't judge me.
Yeah, don't judge me. So now, should you also be, even if you didn't get those roses with the advice, it's come to you. Can this sometimes be a sign that you have to reflect too, that there might be some truth in some of these things that people have been trying to advise
you? Absolutely. Look, Abdullah bin Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, one of the great companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, he said, the most hated words to Allah are, don't judge me. When someone gives you advice and you say, don't judge me. So, you know, if you read the books of spirituality and tazkiyah and Islam and things of that sort, and you read the lives of the companions, one of the things that's consistent is consider advice even from your enemies. Consider what people say about you, even if it's your enemy.
That's deep.
Why? Because perhaps there might be some truth to what he's saying. And a great scholar by the name of Imam Ibn Qudamah, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, if I had a scorpion on my back about to bite me, I would expect someone to point it out to me. So he said, a spiritual disease is far greater than a scorpion, which is going to cause physical harm. So that which would cause me spiritual harm is greater to me. So I would certainly want someone to point that out to me as well. So if someone points something out to me or gives me advice in a very rude manner, quite frankly, with personal insults and just in a disgusting way, then I'm going to ignore the disgust. I'm going to ignore the personal insults, but I'm going to say, hey, there might be a scorpion on me. I'm not going to say, well, I don't like the way you told me about that scorpion. I'm going to go ahead and let it bite me.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So there's a story that I always tell. It's a story from the great Imam, Imam al-Shafi'i. Mm-hmm. He's one of the four Imams of the Orthodox Islam, the Sunni school of thought. And he was once sitting down, and he was a great Imam, giving lectures in the masjid of the Prophet, peace be upon him, in fact, only a few years after the Prophet, peace be upon him, died, 100 years or so after the Prophet, peace be upon him, passed away. He's giving lectures in the mosque. Great Imam. Someone walks into him and says, are you a Shafi'i? He said, yeah, I'm a Shafi'i. He said, innaka fajirun fasiq. You are an evil, wicked man. Now the students of Imam al-Shafi'i wanted to jump this man. Imam al-Shafi'i, he raised his hands and he supplicated and he made dua. He said, Allahumma in kana sadiqan. Oh Allah, if he's telling the truth, فَغْفِرْ لِي وَرْحَمْنِي وَتُبْ عَلَيَّ. Then forgive me and have mercy upon me and accept my repentance. وَإِنْ كَانَ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ. And if he's not telling the truth, he didn't say وَإِنْ كَانَ كَاذِبًا, if he's a liar. He didn't go sink to that man's level. He said, if he's not telling the truth, forgive him, فَغْفِرْ لَهُ وَرْحَمْهُ وَتُبْ عَلَيَّ. Forgive him and have mercy on him and accept his repentance. And so the beauty of that is that, look, in life, you will always have imbalanced praise and you will always have imbalanced criticism. I'm a public figure on my Facebook page, right, or my Twitter. You'll have people that will say, you're so awesome, mashallah, greatest man in the world. Then you'll have, so imbalanced praise. It's. I have to be able to ignore that. And at the same time, you know, I get 300, 400 emails a day of people criticizing, not criticizing things legit, but sometimes mocking me, my appearance, my words, slandering me, my family, right? I've had people say nasty things about my mother, right? Who's passed away, may Allah have mercy on her. People that try to poke at you. And so one of the things that my teacher said, he said, look, you're always going to have cheerleaders and haters. Imbalanced praise and imbalanced criticism. What you need to do is you need to be able to reduce that to noise so that you can recognize balanced praise, which is encouragement, so that shows you what you're doing well, and at the same time balanced criticism so that you don't lose yourself in the process of doing that good, and if it's even good in the first place. So it doesn't matter who's saying what to me, he might be telling the truth, right? And that was the sincerity of Imam al-Shafi'i, that, you know, that person might be telling me the truth, even if I don't like the way that he said it and people don't like the way that he said it. So when someone gives you advice and someone criticizes you and hates on you, ignore the hatred, ignore that, but don't be someone who meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that very characteristic and that very sin that was pointed out to you just because of the way that it was said to you.
That's deep. It's balanced. I love it. It's balanced. Now give some loving advice. There's a lot of people there holding on to the deen by a thread. May Allah protect us from that. It's a scary thing. So now you have the opportunity to reach out. We only got a minute left, and give some loving advice to those who are struggling.
Everyone is struggling with their faith in some way. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, did not teach us Islam as, or faith to us is not being on a constant spiritual high. It's that even whenever you're going through your low moments and you're going through your moments of discouragement and disappointment, you never completely lose faith. And so a lot of times, you know, we're made to feel like low iman, low faith is just like no iman, no faith. Whereas sometimes, you know, your iman, your faith might feel low, you might be going through something in life. Just don't lose faith altogether. Don't sink your own ship. Don't despair as the devil despaired. Always have that balance of fear and hope, and always make sure that you're progressing, even whenever you're feeling low, that you're making amends and that you're progressing towards Allah. And don't lose hope. Everyone goes through their low points.
Beautiful. We have to go, but hadith, it says, talabul ilmi faridatun ala kulli muslim. Is that how it goes?
Yes.
That seeking knowledge is incumbent on every Muslim, and a Muslim is one who submits to the will of God. The fuel for that car is that gas. Fuel for the iman is knowledge. Where can people go? Inflips, I heard. You got some really great stuff there. Tell us about it.
So alhamdulillah, I left imam. I kind of retired early from being an imam just so I could focus on knowledge. My passion is studying and teaching. So I have some, you know, videos on YouTube with Quran Weekly, and I've got some some institutes that I teach with, Mishkai University, Bayina Al-Maghrib Institute. I have classes with them. And my own personal project is ilmflix.com, ilmflix.com. Hundreds and hundreds of hours of Islamic lectures, very unorthodox in regards to the topics that are being addressed. So we're addressing topics that are, so we have some tafsir and things of that sort, explanation of the Quran. And at the same time, we have some topics like fiqh of pregnancy, black companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, how the Prophet fought racism, practical things you can do with your life. So it's hundreds of hours. It's all for free, inshallah. All you have to do is go online and register at ilmflix.com, ilmflix.com, and you get a whole library and live classes, inshallah, as well. Jazakumullah khairan. Thank you all very much.
Well, yeah, thank you very much.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. Thank you. Thank you for being with us. Thank you. And there you have it. So much love to give. That's right. And how are you going to get the love if you don't open your mind and your heart? There's so much love to give, so much loving advice. And now you've gotten it here, some great advice. What are you going to do with it if somebody's been trying to deliver something to you? Like we've been trying to deliver the truth, that there's only one God, that you worship Him alone, not His creation. And you have all of everything that He's sent through this last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon Him. It's encapsulated in Islam. And the loving advice that we've given you, and we're giving you, is to look into Islam. Call us at 1-800-662-ISLAM to get your free Quran so you can see this blueprint that we live by. And then you can see it in action, studying the Prophet Muhammad's life. So we hope to see you back here again next week on The Deen Show. Follow us on the Twitter, like us on the Facebook, where you can keep up with all of our shows. Help share this message. Because if you love, if you care, you share. So make sure you share. And we'll see you next time, God willing, inshallah. Until then, peace be with you.